This is 19th lecture in engineering mechanics. And today we will continue our discussion on problem in friction. So the problem statement, the problem is at page 53, problem number 2. The problem statement is like this: a rectangular block of width 2b and height h rest on a horizontal plane surface. So there is a rectangular block of width 2b and height h rest on a horizontal surface. Find the magnitude of force P and height x, the line of action of the horizontal force. So P is an horizontal force. You have to find out this height, the force P and height at which it is applied. That will cause tipping and sliding of the block to impend simultaneously. So that will cause a tipping and sliding to occur, to impend simultaneously. So these are some important things that we have to notice. The weight of the block is W, and the coefficient of friction, static friction between the block and the plane is mu. So this is a problem statement. So we have to find out the force P at what height x it is applied, such that both tipping and the sliding to occur simultaneously. So yesterday I have shown you the phenomena, and now I will repeat this. You know, this is a rectangular block, so you can do it with your water bottle or any object that is available to you. Now it is on the horizontal surface, that is on the table. Now if I apply a horizontal force P at a distance x, so something can happen here. You can see that it is sliding, okay? So this action is the sliding. So if we apply here at the bottom points, this slides. Now that is about the sliding phenomena. So we have to find out the force P at what height it should be applied, such that the sliding will occur. Then you can see that when I apply the same force at a height, okay, so you see that it tips rather than sliding, it tips. So this is what is meant by tipping of the block. So the problem asks you to find out the magnitude of force P and what point it should be applied, such that both should occur simultaneously. The tipping and the sliding should occur simultaneously. So that is our problem. This is a very important and interesting problem, which we'll use it to explain other phenomena like what is rolling friction. Now first let us take the condition of sliding, and let us see what is the force that is required. So you take the rectangular block, if we apply a force P here that is horizontal, that means it is applied parallel to it, and since the weight is acting, the weight will be supposed to be acting from the center of the block, so you will have a reaction from the floor that will be R. Then not only that, since the friction is there, friction exists between the floor and the block, there will be a friction force. The friction force will be acting along the surface, that is in this case horizontal. So the friction force can act horizontally either this way or this way. But in which direction it will act depends on in what direction this block tends to move. So this block, under the action of the force P, tends to move in this direction. So the resisting friction force will be this. So this will is going to be mu times, or since the vertical reaction R is equal to W, this friction force will be equal to mu times W. Okay, so that is the kind of force that the block will experience. Now for the sliding to occur, sliding to impend, when the sliding impends, then only we can write the friction force, the normal force, the horizontal force. We can write when the sliding impends, the ratio of the friction force F divided by the normal force N. In this case, friction force, we have, that is going to be mu only when the sliding impends. That is why we write it as here, the friction force is equal to mu times W here. The friction force is mu times W. So that also should be equal to the applied force P. Then only the sliding will impend. Okay? So in the sliding impends, the condition is mu W is equal to P, or P is equal to mu times W. So you see this, for considering the sliding only, does it matter if I apply the P here or elsewhere at any height? When you talk about sliding, the condition is that the P should be equal to mu times W. Okay, so that should be overcoming the static friction force. So this is going to be W. So P is equal to mu times W, that is your condition for the sliding to impend. In that case, does it matter at what height you apply P? Does that matter when you consider only the sliding? Forget about the tipping. So when it comes to sliding, it is clear that the height at which this P is applied, as it is immaterial. So we have this condition, P is equal to mu times W is a condition for sliding to impend. Now if you take the other one, that is the tipping to impend, okay, for tipping to impend, same block, you are applying P at a height of X. So W is acting, this distance is half of the width, that is B. So when the tipping impends, this is going to tip, means this the block will lose its contact. When the tipping impends, it will lose its contact with the horizontal. So if I take this as my horizontal floor, when the tipping impends, what happens is it is going to lift itself. So when the tipping impends, means it will lose the contact with the horizontal floor except this point, this corner point. Okay, so when the tipping impends, the block, the entire reaction will be passing through this point, that is through the block. So the reaction here will be the RC, that is what the reaction will, the point through which it will act. It is not difficult to find out what is the direction of this is. So if you get the intersection of these two points. According to the theorem of three forces, this must be passing through this point. So I know the value or the magnitude, the direction of RC. So W is there, direction of RC is there. Here the friction component will not come. So if you want to find out the condition for impending tipping, when the tipping to impend, and the tipping impending to tip, at that stage I can take the moment about a point RC, take the sum of the moment about the center C, that is equal to be zero, because it is still in static equilibrium about to tip. So when you take the moment about this, so that you can ignore the unknown force RC, that effect is cancelled. So you will see the moment of the W and the P, the sum of the moments of these two should be equal. So I can write an equation that this moment about C of W is W times B, that is going to produce an anti-clockwise moment. So that will have a positive sign. Then P into X, that is going to produce a clockwise moment. So it will be minus sign, so that is equal to zero. Therefore we can say that P is equal to WB by X. So this is a condition for tipping to impend. So here you can see that the friction coefficient plays no role, okay, for a tipping, for impending tipping the friction plays no role. For the impending sliding, the height plays no role, the height at which the P is applied plays no role. But the problem asks you to find out both should occur at simultaneously. Then you are to satisfy this equation number one, that is for the equation for impending sliding. Then equation number two, both should be satisfied. When you satisfy these two, then you can find out at what is the magnitude of P and what condition it at what height it should be applied. Okay, so before going to that, we will try to draw these two equations in a graph, so that will give you better understanding. So I'll try to draw the graph between the force, that is P, magnitude of force P, with respect to the position at which it is applied, that is the X. So X is varying. So you know that the point of application, the height at which the force P is applied, can vary from 0 to the maximum of height of the block, that is your H. So this can go up to H, no further, because you cannot apply the force on the block where the block doesn't exist. Above the block you cannot apply. So this is a variable, it vary, X varies from 0 to H. Now I plot the condition of force P for a sliding. Okay, for sliding it is mu times W, so it is independent of X, therefore it will be a constant. So at the height of mu times W, I can draw this line, that is a straight line parallel to the x-axis, because this is a sliding line, I would say. Of course this has to be stopped here. So wherever I apply the force P, it is immaterial that the condition for sliding is P is equal to mu times W only. Now you take the tipping to impend, The force P is given by WB by X. WB, W is the weight of the block, B is the half width of the block, they are constants. And so some constant divided by X, if you try to plot that constant divided by X, that is going to be an asymptotic function going like this. So this is the one for the tipping with the equation some constant times X. Constant is WB by X, okay, if it will be explicit, WB by X, that is the force. So you can see that this two curves are supposed to be intersecting at a point. This point is what we are looking at as per the problem statement. When the P is the magnitude of mu times W, and when you apply at this particular point height, at this height if you apply, then this is going to have both tipping and sliding to occur simultaneously. Okay, so if you go by the equation, we can see that two equations are about P. So we can say that mu times W is equal to WB by X. So W is cancelled out in both. So mu is equal to B by X. What we are looking at is X, that is equal to B by mu. If you take the base B and divided by mu, so B by mu is going to be equal to X. So this is the value of X. So this magnitude, this value is given by B by mu. That is your intersection point. So if you choose to apply the force at a point which is equal to B by mu, then both the tipping and the sliding will occur simultaneously. That is what the feeling is. You have any doubt? Now further to it, see, you can split this point, and from here you can say you can divide this into two regions. So this region are different. If the force is applied at a height below this point where both to occur simultaneously, you can see this region, below this region here, which one will happen? Whether sliding will happen or tipping will happen? Please answer. This is the curve for tipping. This is the curve for sliding. So what will occur? The one which has requires least force will occur. Okay, so this region, the you can see that for this curve, the force P, required force P, is less than what is required for tipping. So this region is where the sliding region. So at this height H, you know, if you apply anything below this height, so if you choose this height as equal to B by mu, so if you apply the force anything below that, you will have a sliding. Okay, so only sliding will occur. You are sure that when you apply here at this region, sliding will occur. Okay, you can leave please. Next is that in this region, if you look at, what will happen? So what is supposed to happen with sliding or tipping? So here what is requiring less force is the tipping. So if you apply your force above this particular height, tipping will occur. So it will tip, it will not slide, it will tip. So this is the region of tipping. Okay, so you from here you can see here, but a certain heights, you know, you apply higher above that, it will tip. If you apply the force below this, it will slide. So it is, what is this problem is about? It's what way it is going to affect you. Say suppose you are moving some heavy objects. If you are moving heavy objects, you know what you will prefer, sliding or tipping? You think of moving a bureau in your house. If suddenly it tips, somebody pushes it, it tips, it may fall. It may overturn and fall or hurt somebody. Okay, so you have to ensure that it is only sliding takes place, not the tipping. Tipping is unwanted there. So what we do is you have to ensure that everybody applies, the force is applied below this point. Or if you want to ensure the sliding only, what you have to do is you have to reduce the friction. This mu w is this, you, if you reduce this friction at a much lower level, you will ensure that wherever you apply, you know, it will slide. So that is why some people, you know, they put a cloth, so and then they will ensure that the friction is low. Okay, so friction is low, so push or move the object. So this way you are sure that if you have a smooth floor, then most likely it will slide rather than it will tip. If you have a rough floor, it will tip most likely. So you have to be careful about it in handling such heavy object, so to ensure that tipping doesn't occur. Okay, now comes the another important extension of this problem. Okay, this problem ends here as per the Timoshenko is concerned. He just ask you to find out this, even this curve is not there. Now about this, one more small discussion is this, is a curve. So this we have said it is B by mu. So another way to ensure that always sliding will occur, not tipping, is that the height itself is less than this B by mu. Don't have this rectangular block, the height itself you reduce such that it is less than B by mu, you cannot apply. Wherever you apply there, you will ensure only sliding will take place because you are already in this regime. Okay, you have no way to apply here in this regime because the height itself is cut down to this length. So but the rectangular block, if you see that if I take this height, then I will see that always sliding will occur wherever I apply, no tipping, because it is in the sliding region only. But if the height is like this, the tipping is also possible. Okay, one more important point is, like when you talk about static equilibrium, the static equilibrium can be disturbed by the two ways. One is sliding, that is a linear translation, or it can tip. Okay, it need not slide, it can tip. So these are the two ways the static equilibrium can be disturbed for an object. Now there is something related here before we go further. You think of a situation where you have the block, there is no tipping sliding problem here. I will just take the block here, I put the block here and I push this. See, it is in equilibrium now. I apply the force, it is not moving. I increase the force, it is not moving ahead. I am increasing further, it is not moving. So increasing further like this, at one point of time it starts sliding. So what is the kind of a force? How do you draw the force? If I say x-axis is the time and I linearly increase the force what is applied, what is the friction force? How the friction force that is going to change with respect to time t? So I have this force here. How the friction force will change with respect to time t if I apply the force linearly? So what will happen is, if I apply the linear force, it will go like this linearly. The friction force also will be increasing in magnitude, and so that it balances. But it will balance to such an extent only because it is a limited amount of resistance. So it will go up to this only. Then after that, it gives away. So this is the maximum value, that is your maximum limiting static friction. If you increase it further, you see that, you know, at this point of time the sliding impends. When the sliding impends, immediately the friction will change. The condition no longer will be static, it will be a dynamic friction, which is always found to be less. So after that, to maintain it a constant velocity, what you have to apply is, you have to just apply enough force to balance. So this is the friction force. This is how the friction force would be when you try to start this to slide and the sliding is occurring simultaneously. This region is a static friction region. This region is your dynamic friction region. Okay, so that is the two regions. So the value of this here is slightly less than the maximum limited static friction force. Okay, now I told you that the friction is one of the responsible for dissipating energy. Kinetic energy will be dissipated because of the friction. But you know one important thing, static friction will not dissipate any energy, because when you say try to push it, it is in equilibrium. Whatever the static the friction force will be there, but there is no relative motion, because the energy laws or work done will be the force and the displacement. In the case of static friction region, there is no relative displacement, so energy will not be dissipated. Whereas only in the dynamic friction range, energy will be dissipated. That's another important key point. Now, coming to I want to move this block from point A to point B. Say let it be an horizontal floor. I want to move this block. Then how to move it with least energy? Okay, see your cell phone. If you are working on your cell phone, okay, you can quit, go out. Please go out. You don't have to be here. Now, I want to move this block from point A to point B with the least effort, without wasting much of my energy. How to do that? Tell me. Now, I'll put it on the table. I want to move this block from here to this end of the table. If I try to slide it, that is also one way of moving it. If I try to slide it, I know that the friction force is opposing that motion. So friction force into displacement, you will see that when you move the block from point A to point B here, the friction force is mu times W. Mu in this case is mu dynamic times W because it is motion. So that displacement is in this direction. If I say the displacement is, say, yes, then the work done is mu times dw into s, that is the force into displacement. This is the work done. But this work done will have a negative sign, because you see that force and displacement are in the opposite direction. The friction force acting against the direction of displacement, so this will be work done is negative. The work done will be positive only if the force applied direction and the displacement, force and displacement are in the same direction. So you know that force into displacement is a dot product. In this case, the angle of this will be 180, so you will have a minus sign. Okay, so this is a negative work which will be done when you are moving the object from here to here. So definitely you will be wasting some energy. No issue about it, there will be a wastage of energy. Now I want to move this from A to B with the least energy. How to do that? So definitely I should not slide. If I slide, definitely it will consume energy. So what I can do is, I can tip it. So I can tip it like this, tip it, tip it, tip it like this. When I tip this way, how much energy I have to spend? See, I am not, there is a friction force. Friction force will be there at the corner, but it will not be, there is only static friction force. There is no relative motion. So when you tip this like this, you know, from here, like this, tip it here, again tip, like this, I'll be spending very less energy, isn't it? Because I am not involving any dynamic friction force. So in that case, energy spent will be less. So if I want to build a car or move a vehicle, then the wheels should be such that the wheels should not slide. You should only tip, 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 tip like that. But there is a problem in using this kind of a rectangular block in tipping. What are the problems? You see that if I have a wheel, cycle wheel like this, in this shape, imagine what will be the consequence. What will be the consequence? First, the center of your height of this itself will go up, then drop, go up, drop. It's not going to be a smooth ride. And also you will see qualitatively the accelerations are going to be not uniform. So I will not be using a rectangular block. So let me try to use a square block. Okay, if I use a square block, what will happen? Let us see. I use a square block, a square this thing as a wheel. I have a square wheel. Okay, let me. Okay, I have this. If I let it be on a horizontal floor like this, then I apply a force so that it tips, goes like this. Again, I apply a force so that it tips, goes like this. But you know, just now you have learned that when you apply a force, you have to apply at a particular height so that tipping only will occur. Not only that, the sliding friction is also, the static friction also is sufficiently high, it should be high, so that it won't impend, the sliding won't impend. Okay, so you should ensure for this to happen. So I'll apply a force, I should apply at a height, at the same time I should be, the static friction should be sufficiently high so that sliding won't occur. Okay, so now it will be the motion like this, tipping about this point, this point, this point, this is. So if I tip it like this, then I am going to apply this force through the center. The weight is going to be W. This width of the block I say is B. This, because it is a square, this is also B. So I'll change this notations a little bit. I'll take this Y and this is X. So for the tipping to impend, what is the condition? Py is equal to Wx, taking moment about this point. So P is equal to Wx by Y. So this is the force required. My intention is that I have to tip, tip, tip like that. At the same time, I should make this ride smooth. I should be spending least force also. Okay. Now let us just look at what will happen qualitatively. What will happen? This is about to tip. Okay. So when motion impends, or the tipping impends, this is the equation. But what will happen if I tilt it a little bit? You see that W will be still vertical, P is still horizontal. If I apply the force through an axle here, imagine there is a hinged connection through which I am applying the force P. I make sure that it is always horizontal. In that case, what will happen is that if I slightly tilt this, so what will be the force, the dynamics of it? Let me draw this at a slight angle. So this is at an angle. So now W will be vertical and P is horizontal. Now you see that this Y has slightly increased. Okay, so you can see, because it is from this position, this is increased, the center rises up, so the arm of P increases, the arm of Y decreases, the arm of W decreases. I'm not going into the quantitative aspect of it. Qualitatively you can see that when the tipping impends, this is the equation, but as it tips, if the tipping is occurring, you can see this is reducing and this is increasing. That means this moment reduces and this increases, means there will be a higher, as it rolls over it or tips over this, the moment will increase further and further. Okay, so when you start here, it's just the moment is equal, so that it is just starts to roll over, but as it tips about this point, because of this arm is reducing and this arm of this Y is increasing, you will have more, the moment of this will become more and more, net moment acting on this to tip will increase. Then what will happen here when you take this, for example, you have tipped like this, it is vertical, or it can even go further down. So now this is W, this is P, so this is going to be your X and this is going to be your Y. What happens here when it rolls over from this to this,
Now there is a position where W is vertical, passing through the point C, then only P will be acting. Then further to it, you see both W and P are in the same direction. So that means it will roll like this with a greater couple acting on it. So what kind of motion this will have is an accelerated motion. So this will start like this, it will accelerate and go and strike. So it will fall like heavily. Okay, so you will have, what is the kind of a motion is, you will, if you have this as a wheel, this kind of a square section as a wheel, this will accelerate, it will climb and accelerate and fall, accelerate, accelerate like this. It will not be a smooth continuous motion, there will be a intermittent accelerated motion. So that is one problem. The another problem is this height, as you say, will go up and come down, it will not be smooth at all. Okay, so what should I do is I should think of improving my shape of the wheel. Instead of a square wheel, I can think of, say, a hexagon wheel. So if I think of a hexagon wheel like this, then whether things will improve, we have to see. We have to see based on what is x and y. So this is your distance x, this is your distance y. So when you think of this x and y as the distances, you can see that you can construct this triangle and calculate what is x and y. So this is going to be your, the 360 divided by 2 times n. N is the number of faces of your polygon. In this case it is 6. If I am going to increase this to an octagon where 8 faces are there like that, so this angle is 360 divided by 2n, that is the angle. If I take that x as some value and what is the y value here, I can find out. If I define this y as of my height, I can find out what is x. So what my intention is, I have to see what is the, how the things are improving as I increase the number of faces of the polygon of the wheel that I am trying to do. So I have made a tabulation. Now you can see that if I have my polygon wheel, if it has 4 faces, my theta by 2, that is what I am talking about, will be, that is computed by 360 divided by 2n. So that will be 45 degrees. Now this ratio between the x and y, this x is the moment, because you see that x by y is the ratio that decides what is p. So if I take x by y, that is going to be tan theta. If I take the ratio of x by y, that is equal to tan theta. Similarly, if I take, what is this height, if I take this height as r, that r is going to be y by cos theta is my r. So I can find out that another ratio of 1 by cos theta. So if I calculate it, this is going to be 1, this is 1.414. If I take this at a 6, the angle is 30, this is 0.577, this is 1.154. If I take it as 8, it is 22.5, it is 0.414, 1.082. If I take, say for example, 24 faces polygon, it is angle is 7.5, it is 0.131, it is 1.00. 8.6. Then this is, if I take it as 240, then it is 0.75, is 0.0130, is 1.00085. What this table and what this values mean physically is that this table of tan theta is x by y, that decides me what is the force that is required in terms of W. Given the weight of the wheel is acted upon by weight W, the ratio, that is P, is x by y times W. That means I see here that by conserving a particular height y, then I see that this tan theta is decreasing. Okay, if I increase the number of faces of the polygon wheel, I get an advantage, the P is reduced, because this factor, if I put for a given weight W, I have to apply least force P. And what is this 1 by cos theta means? 1 by cos theta tells me how much my center goes up and down. So initially, if I have a square one, the center goes much above and comes down, but that oscillation, that the comes down, it's one means it stays almost. So from this I can see that instead of using a square, I use a polygon with a very high number of faces, uniform polygon with a large number of faces, I find that the force required to tip this reduces, and also the center stays as it is. Now if I extend this argument further, I make this to infinity, a polygon with infinite face as your wheel, then this will become zero. The force required to move that is zero. Then what is this? It will stay in the same place. That, what is that is? That is nothing but wheel, a circular wheel. Okay, if you take a circular shape, then if it stays as a circle irrespective of your force that is being applied, if I take a circular wheel like this, so if the force is applied, W is acting here, what is P required is zero. That means what? If I have a perfect circle, I don't require any force to move. That means I have the most efficient mode of transport. But unfortunately, in real world, we don't have such a wheel. It is not a wheel alone, it is the interaction of the wheel and the contacting floor also. If the contacting floor is, this may be a rigid wheel so that it won't deform, but suppose it is on a sand, then it is not going to be this, this is not going to be zero. So why this, let me just say, what happens here is you don't require zero here, always you require some force to move. Even though you are using a circular wheel, it requires some force. The wheel always has some elasticity, so it deforms because of the weight that is applied. So what happens is here, there is a small deformation. Flattening of the tire happens. This flattening of the tire, W is acting here. So this is your distance x. This is your distance x. and this is your certain height y. So P is, as you said, WX by Y. Now you can see, if you are having an elastic wheel, that is your rubber tired wheel will deform in the phase of interaction. So that deformation acts like a kind of a polygon, okay? But the rest of the things are circular, but as it rolls this again and again, it will, this kind of a flat face will come. So this distance is going to be x, this is your y. So this is your force required. It is not going to be zero. There will be, x is not zero. If x is zero, perfect rigid wheel, force required is zero. But x is some value, finite value, then you will have a force required. Some force is required. Okay, so how to determine that this force, that is given by x and y. So as if you don't inflate your tires properly, what will happen? If you don't inflate the tires properly, this length will increase. It will be more flat, mean this length will increase, that x will increase, mean greater force is required. If you inflate your tires hard so that this distance, this flat will come down, this distance will decrease, then what will happen is P is reduced. So that is the reason you can say, explain why it is hard to move a less inflated tire compared to what is the fully inflated tire. Fully inflated tire, this length will be less, so your effort required for rolling this wheel is decreased. Okay, now how to decrease it further? How to decrease this further? You should have a very hard wheel on a hard surface. Hard wheel on a hard surface means you have a steel wheel on steel rail, then the deformation will be very less. So that is what happens in railways. Railway, why do they use a steel wheel on a steel track? They could have used ordinary, you know, rubber wheels are on a road, but they preferably use it on a steel wheel on a steel track so that this deformation is very less. So always you know that transporting goods through train is less expensive compared to your bus, because the bus uses a flexible rubber tire. Okay, but there is another thing you can note it down. It also depends on why. You can increase your, reduce your traction force, we use a larger wheel. Use a larger wheel with a greater y, also you can reduce the traction force. So you, by looking at the equation, you can see that larger wheel reduces the traction force required to move, and this harder wheel also, it is good, but it is not like that. If you say, for example, it is not about the wheel alone, it also the interaction between the wheel and the floor. Okay, suppose you are on a, you have taken your cycle on a sand, you find it very difficult to move because your wheel is all right, but the ground or the floor is not hard enough, so that deforms, increasing this your length. Okay, so on a sand, it is very difficult for you to ride your cycle. Even you move your cycle, it is because that is a sand is one which is soft, so this, the cycle wheel embeds, so this distance increases, increasing this. So what is called now is P is equal to, you can give a the measure of the resistance for the wheels to roll, that is coefficient of rolling resistance mu roll. This is the equation, P is equal to mu roll W by Y. So mu roll is nothing but X, this distance. So your mu static friction, mu dynamic friction, these coefficient has no values, no dimensions, whereas a rolling friction has a dimension in terms of centimeters. Okay, so when it comes to the traction or automobiles, if you want to reduce the effort, increase larger wheel, have a larger wheel and inflate it hard, ride it on a hard surface like a concrete, then your efficiency will increase. Suppose you go on a muddy road, your efficiency will come down, the mileage will be poor. Okay, that is what you have to do. So what we have discussed in this class, we talked about the tipping and the sliding problem. From there we have extended into a wheel and how the wheels roll, what are the factors involved in it. Then you have the rolling resistance is measured, the unit in terms of centimeter. We have explained why less inflated tires are difficult. I told you, you can check the difference between a loading rolling resistance and a sliding resistance in your cycle itself. Take a cycle, roll the cycle, you can see the effort. Lock that two wheels, you lock that wheels, try to move it, now the sliding friction acts. So that will be much higher than your rolling friction. Okay, so we are able to live in a better society because of the invention of the wheel. So without the invention of the wheel, whether they have gone through this logic or not, but they have found out the wheel. So because of that wheel, it is very easy for us to transport the things. Okay, so with this we'll stop.